Osceola Sisters and Brothers, brothers and sisters, welcome. I was recently reminded that some time ago, I promised to teach some songs, and so I got some feedback that suggested that getting people in right space prior to hearing these sermons and stories would be to add a song to the tape, a video. And anyway, so that's what I'm going to do. And I thought, well, to start with, I'm going to rely upon, or begin sharing with you, Cherokee hymns and history, or Cherokee history and it's Cherokee Hymns, History, and Hum by Prentice and Willina. We want to remember that Sister has crossed over, and Prentice has remarried, so we want to recognize that. But this is a collection of Trail of Tears hymns. Now, many Cherokees have been believe in Christianity, believe in Christ for our own reasons, and so it's the same among most Native Americans in North America. But one thing was true is that the Trail of Tears, also known as the Bloody Trail, from the East Coast out here to Indian Territory in 1834, many American Indians died of many nations, and it's considered the North American Holocaust. And so this collection of hymns represents many, if not all, of the songs that were sung by the people while they walked the trail carrying the bodies of their dead family members. And so, Chief Donner John Ross carried his own daughter in his arms the whole distance. So the story goes. And there are many other stories like that, including one disciples missionary who walked the trail and lost his daughter on that trail as well. And so this time we're going to begin from the beginning, as my old music teacher liked to say, and we're going to start with Amazing Grace. So without further ado. Unelana iuweji igaguya eini na kujosa wiuose igaguya. Oh, yeah. Isaiah 56:1-8. Thus says God, maintain justice and do what is right. For soon my salvation will come and my deliverance be revealed. Happy is the mortal who does this, the one who holds it fast, who keeps the Sabbath, not profaning it, and refrains from doing any evil. Do not let the foreigner join to God say, God will surely separate me from God's people. Then do not let the eunuch say, I am just a dry tree. For thus says God, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, who choose the things that please me, and hold fast to my covenant, I will give in my house and within my walls a monument and a name. Better than sons and daughters, I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. And the foreigners who join themselves to God, to minister to Him, to love the name of God, and to be God's servants, all who keep the Sabbath and do not profane it, and hold fast to my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel, I will gather others to them besides those already gathered. And our reading today from the Gospel of Matthew is Chapter 21, verses 10 through 14. I'm sure many of you are very familiar with this. It's a short read of a longer reading, but it is very relevant to our topic today. When he, meaning Jesus in this context, or Jesus, entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, who is this? The crowds were saying, this is the prophet Jesus of Nazareth in Galilee. Then Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who were selling and buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. He said to them, it is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer. But you are making it a den of robbers. The blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he cured them. Sacred space is a place of empowerment, a place of healing, a space for working on building one's relationship to God or with God. Now, in our Indian religious tradition, we do have an understanding that nothing is sacred until it is made so. And this is open to interpretation, for it is also true that God's presence is in all things and everywhere around us. But God has given us the power, and God has empowered us to create sacred space. Sacred space being equivalent to safe space. What exactly does that mean? Well, from a Protestant perspective, I guess that might be a little bit challenging to grasp and understand in many contexts, although I'm sure that there are many who do understand it. In the Indian religious context, everyone understands it. There are spaces that are so sacred to us, no one would even consider defiling them. For example, the Asid, the sweat lodge, and the teaching of our people. These are holy of holy places for us. The Sundance circle. These are holy of holy places. And in these places where we come to pray and to suffer for the people, to give of ourselves that others may live as we were shown how to do by those who came before us, including Yeshua or Jesa or Jesus, depending on whatever name you want to call him by. He knows all languages, so it doesn't really make that much difference. In these places, they are places of healing, places of peace, where you are challenged, most definitely challenged, to rise above the pettiness of this world, to rise above the inherent characteristics of our personalities, which cause us to harm ourselves and others, and to grow and evolve in a good and healthy way with our Creator, with each other, with community, so that we can be of good service to God and to the people throughout all of creation. That is what these spaces are for. That is why they are sacred. We recognize that the people who come into these places are wounded. They're hurt. Many have been through serious trauma. And so we think about what kind of space is necessary in order to help these people feel safe, that they may be able to receive the healing that they need to grow in a good way, to find that peace that they cannot find anywhere else in this world. That is for us, in our Indian religious tradition, what sacred space embodies, what it represents. It is a place of ritual. It is a place where people can feel and know, experience the living presence of God. And that is what we see in Isaiah. God, back in the day, to the Israelites and to all the people, including the foreigners, after the exile, God changed, through Isaiah, expectations for the life in the temple. And God called the Israelites to a new way of thinking through Isaiah, which actually is not entirely true because it's throughout the entire story, but this was a blatant statement that everybody is welcome in God's house. No one is to be excluded. And God's house is to be a place of prayer, a sacred space, a healing space. And so from there, we can move forward into the New Testament with this in mind and see that even for Christ, just how significant sacred space is. You know, Christ went everywhere and did everything, and he did healings outside the temple, he did teachings outside the temple, he was out on the countryside, he was in people's homes, and you know, he went to these places and he taught and he shared, but when he came to temple, when he came to that sacred space, he had the expectation that that sacred space would be honored in a good way. And when he saw how it had been defiled by those who had deceived the people, who had corrupted God's intention for creation, and had led the people astray through the exercising of, well, let's face it, you know, human beings are really good at rationalizing and justifying just about anything. And I'll get into that some more a little bit. But in this temple situation, Christ had seen that God's temple, that sacred space of prayer and healing, had been defiled, and he did something about it. He made a whip while he was sitting there, and he ran people out, threw the crap out of the temple, and he restored it to sacred space by curing the people right where he was, in the temple. And that act restored God's sacredness in that place. God's intention for sacred space was restored in that place, right then and there. And it really upset the people in charge, I'll tell you that. They had a fit about it. And, but, you know, what can they say? Because after Christ went on his tirade, he turned around and cured the blind and the ill, right there in front of everybody. So obviously, it was important to God to restore the sacredness of that space. Now today, we think about in our contemporary context, you know, why is it important to maintain a sacred and healing space? Well, wow, we live in a world of chaos. We live in a world where pain and suffering abounds. And as I said before, it's easy for people to be led astray. For example, you know, in our Indian religious tradition, we have many stories about our faults and foibles, reminders of how easy it is for us to be lost on the trail. And an example of this was characterized and internalized by Alex Woodward in his book, For the Sender, Love Is Not a Feeling. And it makes my heart sing to know that he took one of our stories, internalized it, and made it live for him, and it helped to facilitate his healing. And this is a wonderful book. Everybody, I encourage you to check it out. But the story, as it's told by the old ones, goes that long ago, at the beginning, the animals and human beings got along with each other and used to talk to each other. And I've talked about this before because in the stories that I've shared. And back in this time, when the people were talking and being together, Coyote came to the human beings and said, "Hey, you know, you're different. You're better than us. So, you know, why should you be listening and taking orders from the animals? You should be doing your own thing. And the best way to do that is to create your own language." And the way it was put to the human beings at the time, Coyote, of course, Coyote being the trickster, I've already shared that story, they bought into the deception. And they did. They created their own language. And then they started keeping secrets from the animals, separating themselves from the animals. Then they started hunting the animals and feeding on them. And it made the animals frightened. And they began to pull away from the human beings, go deeper into the forests and into the mountains. And God looked upon what was going on and was very upset with the way human beings were treating the animals. And so God caused an earthquake to separate the grounds, to make it harder for the human beings to get to the animals and to keep the animals safer. And as this was beginning and the grounds were beginning to separate, the human beings realized the seriousness of their choice, what they had done, and the consequences that it was having both on them and on their friends. And they were in great distress. And they cried out to the animals, "Please don't abandon us. Come join us. We will change our ways." The animals were frightened and went deeper into the forest to get away. They didn't believe them. Imagine that. But two animals had faith. And just before the gap became so wide that the animals could no longer jump across, two ran and jumped across. One was the horse, and the other was the dog. And for their courage, God blessed them and said that these two animals would forever be the companions of the people. And from that time on, Indians have revered the horse. It is a magic animal. And the dog is the companion and protector. And so it is. And this story illustrates how easily we can be deceived. I mean, we go all the way back to Genesis and talk about that, but that's a different sermon because we'll get into that later. But in truth, human beings do have that capacity to be deceived, to rationalize and justify. And what I see today here in this place that we are meeting, not necessarily this room, but in this building and across North America, there are many Christian denominations who are revisiting the origins and turning back to, in this case, bringing beer back into the church. And the justification for this is that Martin Luther and Calvin themselves supported drinking beer in church. Well, historically that's true. I've done the research, I've read myself, where Martin Luther refused to write a sermon unless he had a mug full of beer in his hand. I mean, these guys were opposed to drunkenness, I want to make that clear. But at the same time, you know, we're looking at two priests here who were really upset and in opposition to the corruption within the Catholic Church, but at the same time, they were still condoning and supporting theologies which many now perceive as being equally corrupt. And I know that's going to upset a few of you. But it's true. When you look back at the theologies and you break them down and you look at where Martin Luther and Calvin were coming from, what their motives were for what they were doing, you will also see that they were continuing to perpetuate a theology of moral superiority, a theology which embodied at the time the Catholic Church's belief in moral superiority, and is now known as a theology which perpetuates the doctrine of Christian discovery. Martin Luther and Calvin's theologies were the foundation for the missionary belief to North America that it was God's blessing to exterminate and to enslave the pre-existing citizens of the Western Hemisphere. Now, I'm not talking just about North America. I'm talking about the entire Western Hemisphere, from the Arctic to the Antarctic, both. Millions were slaughtered in the name of God. Millions more were enslaved in the name of God because of the theologies perpetuated by Martin Luther and Calvin and all their descendant followers who created denominations in North America that still exists today, including disciples, Christian Church Disciple of Christ. Go back and read that part of it. So it's easy, like proof texting, to pick out certain aspects of the forebears that are appealing to certain individuals who, out of desperation, smacks of an air of desperation, are seeking to find some justification, some excuse to draw more people in, generate more revenue, keep the churches open because Christianity, Protestant Christianity, North America is dying off. Instead of turning to God's intention for sacred space, a space that welcomes those who are wounded. I mean, think about it for a second here. If you were a victim of domestic violence or incest, would you want to walk into a church where people are sitting around in a congregation boozing it up, knowing that the reason that you were a victim of domestic violence and incest was directly correlated to alcohol and drugs? As a former social worker, or actually still a social worker, but therapist, longtime minister, who worked with as a domestic violence counselor and working with people in recovery, I know for a fact that there is a direct correlation between drinking alcohol, going to marijuana use, going to harder drugs. I've worked with way too many people, done way too much research to believe anything otherwise. And I know for a fact that there is a great deal more domestic abuse going on in Christianity, especially in Protestant Christianity, in North America than has ever been reported. And is directly related to drinking. And yet, here are people who, instead of relying upon God's inspiration, going back to God's word, inspired word, God's intention for a creation, to think about what do people really need, to check with the people on the street who, the young people today, want ritual. They want to know, they want to be able to feel God's presence in that sacred space, in that safe space. And that is why it's so important to look at how Christ talked about sacred space and how God talked about sacred space. People want to be able to feel God's presence, and I guarantee you, it's pretty hard to feel God's presence when you're under the influence of the demon of alcohol. Every American Indian religious leader knows about the consequences of the demon of alcohol. You want to be an inspiration? You want to attract more people? Reach out in service to the community. Restore a ritual, fasting, prayer vigils. When's the last time your church had a 24-hour prayer vigil, fasting prayer vigil? When's the last time you did an in-house candlelight service all night long, praying for God to bless you and your community with the living water, the stream of life? When did you reach out to the wounded in the community by sponsoring domestic violence space, teachings, protection? I mean, there's a lot of options, a lot of options. Take me all day to go through the list, and they don't include drinking. Sacred space must be a safe space for those who are lost and wounded, to have the opportunity to heal and to grow in their relationship with God, with the people, with all of creation. Keeping space sacred takes love, dedication, and devotion to being in right relationship with God and all of creation. May God bless you and guide you in your journey. Walk in beauty. Whatever.